Oh man, Arash, let's do a podcast.
All right, pal. Let's hammer this out so we don't have to talk to each other for a week. Let's go.
What?
What? Did I do that? Did I do that, Ryan? Oh, Butterfingers. Sometimes the words I think come out of my mouth.
We get a lot of shots. Everybody comes to the net. We just have to get more and more pucks to the net.
I'm about to listen to Pucks on Net.
We used to talk about in Vancouver getting pucks on net.
Pucks on net.
What are you saying about putting pucks on net?
This is JT Miller with the Vancouver Canucks, and you're listening to Pucks on Net.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on it.
Live on tape from a myriad of locations. This is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast that doesn't talk about fantasy, but probably will talk about fantasy stats. Another satellite hot stove edition of the podcast coming at you. My name is Ryan Schapp. I'm going to be your host of the evening. I'm coming to you from my apartment above the grounds of the old haunted Burger King. If you head north over the Iron Workers Memorial Bridge to the village of Deep Cove, to the Prince of Pomegranate, Mr. Arash Mamar's today. Arash, how are you doing tonight?
It's over, Ryan. It's over. Everyone put out your Canucks cough flags.
No, it's not over. It's just...
Get out of here. This is the playoff push edition of the podcast.
PPP. Yeah, Bruce, there it is.
Bruce, there it is indeed.
Yeah, wow. Here we are, still here. We're still doing this, huh?
This is the measuring stick.
Guys, okay.
Wednesday night.
I know people are really tired of hearing. Anyway, Canucks have unfortunately lost a 4-1 loss to the Duck Dynasty crew, a.k.a. the St. Louis Blues.
Missouri. Yeah, tough, not the most inspiring game. I do also want to say that Gita's not on the podcast this week. She was on week to week, I would say. I was talking to her this week or yesterday. She's essentially JT Miller behind the scenes. She is swamped like a motherfucker.
Here's the deal. I'm going to clear the air up because Ryan's doing this thing because this is the thing with Ryan, okay? He avoids conflict. He doesn't talk to his dad about his issues. He doesn't talk to Amanda. He doesn't talk to his dog. He only talks to, his barber and the bartender, I'm going to clear up the air, okay? This is the thing. So Gita, unfortunately, needs a type of neck surgery, a neck fusion surgery. And she wants to have a fusion surgery, like a graph thing. Now, Ryan and I disagree with the type of surgery that she needs to have. I'm not going to lie. We've invested a lot into this Gita thing.
She's a franchise player.
Okay, we put all of our coins into this feminist thing. Okay, the chicks need to have rights too. That's what we believe. Now,
where are you going with
that? I'm just wait. Okay, now she wants surgery, and we're just in a disagreement. So technically, she's just on LTIR until we can all come to agreement on. Should we let Gita have the neck fusion surgery, or do we have? Is she going to ask for a move? To
Vegas.
Don't know. What's a podcast? What's a good podcast?
We'll call it like Knights of the Round Table, a Golden Knights podcast.
Yeah, My Favorite Murder. There we go. That's a murder podcast. Everyone loves My Favorite Murder. She asked for a trade to My Favorite Murder.
But yes, Gita's.
Just in case,
I guess
you were
still week to week. Yeah, she's on the LITR for scam related reasons. And when she comes back, we're going to be
She'll be ready for the playoffs.
And we're going to be way more. We're going to be way higher than $18 million over the salary cap because that's what Gita is worth to this podcast.
So in debt to Gita.
Yeah, but we're. My mother texted me because she watches all the Instagram stories, and she's like, "Where's Gita?" And I'm like, she's very, very busy. And she's like, okay, well, just okay. I'm all right then.
She's been actually doing quite a lot. She's very busy. She's been doing landscaping. Yeah.
Well, pal, the Canucks don't have a lot of stuff going on. They didn't get the memo over the weekend that you're supposed to score a shitload of goals and break NHL records because they're not doing that.
They won against Dallas.
Yeah.
And then they came to this game, and then what's the one thing we've been harping about? What's their Achilles heel?
The starts?
Yeah, but, like, you have two heels.
Yaroslav Halak's cursed stick?
I don't think this game is in any fault to Yaroslav Halak. I think he was actually pretty good in this game. But it's just they struggle with teams of speed. They're just not fast enough. If this is the Islanders, if this is the Devils, if this is the Blues, they just cannot handle teams that can come at them with waves and waves of forechecking speed and transition speed. They just can't do it.
They start to slow down physically, and like watching guys like Brock Besser tonight versus St. Louis, they seem to slow down mentally. Like we can't skate and hustle our way out of these predicaments, but if I just think a little bit longer about my shot, I'll be, oh, never mind, it didn't work.
Yeah, Conor Garland had a really weird game. You know, Conor Garland is really interesting. I'm giving it a bit more thought, but Conor Garland's a really interesting player where I think one thing that people tend to sway on with him is that because he's a very noticeable player, and he has, like, aka points.
Some points.
That they think, oh, man, no, he's always in it. And he's always in the thing. But the problem, like, tonight, he was like, full guns ablazing, like, going. But he needed to take a step back. Like, his start was great. But then he took a tripping penalty on Jordan Kyrou.
Yep. And which could have been, I was listening on the radio, it sounded like it could have been a lot worse.
I mean, it could have been a clipping, like a knee on knee, almost, like it was, but it seemed more of like a on the toe thing. I'd have to watch the replay again, but so he does that, and then he's the last man back at the blue line trying to make a move to get the puck down deep, and then makes a giveaway. It's a 2-on-1 the other way. David Perron scores to make it 2-0. It's really interesting to view a player like that that is so finesse driven.
Yeah.
That, you know, like when it comes to playoff time, like, man, is that going to work? Like, are you going to be able to do the drag move behind the net? Are you going to be able to do like he does these amazing passes, like these spin passes out of the corner, like to someone open and stuff. But it just seems like it's sometimes he's just playing in his own world.
He kind of reminds me of me playing Chell with you and friends, where I'm just hitting the spinorama button as much as possible, thinking this will get myself out of this jam. But yeah, they weren't harping on him. They were kind of giving him an office space. What is it you say you do here? Kind of treatment on the radio, where yes, he can have those smart setup passes and he can be that finesse guy, you know, that's always spinning, avoiding checks, trying to drive the play, but it just doesn't seem to be as effective as it was maybe in the start of the year, where we were proclaiming not if but just how elite Connor Garland was. And when I see him do those things that draw your attention to Garland, whether it's a spin, when it's evading a check where he's playing Montreal Canadiens hockey, or doing something flashy and you notice him, or you look at the advanced stats or the fancy stats where he's got good ones because he's always putting the puck on net. It ain't necessarily the most dangerous of scoring chances, but he's still doing it.
Just to interrupt very quickly, do we need a button every time one of us unironically says puck on net or pucks on net?
Yeah, we'll probably need a button, and then we'll have to correct it and say shots to the goal, because that's what we're supposed to be saying.
We need just like a, what is it? You remember, it's like, what's the word that Krusty uses in The Simpsons? He's like, that's our word of the day.
Secret word of the day, like Pee Wee Herman.
Yeah, Pee Wee Herman, just word of the day.
It reminds me of like years ago when we had Kyle Elwood on the show, and we were talking about just playing in the playoffs and he made a great point where it's like, yeah, players in the playoffs like go around and spend their whole shift laying out, like they try to be Milan Lucic against the Medicine Hat Tigers, laying big hits. But it's like yeah, you're drawing the crowd, you know, you're getting the crowd going, but you're horribly out of position for so many, you know, for your other your teammates. Mm-hmm. And if anything goes wrong, you're completely screwed in your own zone. And not that I'm saying that Connor Garland's necessarily screwed in his own zone, but it's you always notice him, but it's not, there isn't a lot of finish to what he's doing.
Well, it's just like there's just a lot of it's a lot of flash and a lot of finesse.
Mm-hmm.
That results to a lot of plays dying.
Yes.
And sometimes when they're executed correctly, they make like a highlight reel. You're like, whoa, that's effing crazy, right?
Mm-hmm.
But just some, it is, most of the time it ends up, the play just dies.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what I've been seeing with the team. I mean, as we're getting to this kind of doomsday clock scenario where...
Whoa. Playoff push scenario.
Okay, playoff
push. Wave your white towels, everybody.
Okay, Bruce, there it is.
Ryan Whitney, everybody. Ryan Whitney.
Ryan Whitney, Bruce, there it is. yeah, I mean, so we're going on this playoff push, and it's like we're seeing, like, it's on again, off again.
Yeah.
They are playing their fourth game in six nights.
They've been playing very well. They've been playing against tough teams. You know, on Wednesday, they had arguably their most complete impressive victory with Halak and Ned against the Colorado Avalanche. A game nobody, literally nobody, gave them a snowball's chance in hell of winning. And they played the most complete defensive game I've seen the Bruce There It Is boys do. And then you see the exact opposite against St. Louis, where there's just this level of comfort and they take the foot off the gas and relax. And next thing you know, everybody that has the puck on the half boards in the neutral zone just seems to give it up at every opportunity possible to the Blues.
Well,
it's just kind of disheartening.
Yeah, well, it's just, I mean, I know we repeat ourselves every week, but it really does go back to the idea of like them being... This is what they are. They're not as good as they,
yeah.
or not as bad as they were at the start. Not as good as they were now, or during the Bruce run. But yeah. So now you know they on Wednesday night they play St. Louis again. You're hoping for Jordan Binnington. You're hoping that hey, you know, we get the auto 2 points from our boy. you know, the guy who thought he deserved the Calder.
Bitter taste in his mouth.
Yeah. It would have been really great if they had somehow managed to get 2 points or even 1 point tonight.
Yeah.
If they had managed to come back. It is just really apparent. I mean, you look at Höglander being injured, you look at just their depth, like it one thing I will say, so you know, okay, so they trade Tyler Mott for a fourth. And they replace Tyler Mott with William Lockwood, whom is essentially Tyler Mott.
I thought Matt Highmore was essentially Tyler Mott.
He's
too.
Another one, but he's injured. Wait, week to week.
He doesn't grow on the Tanner Pearson tree.
I would argue that there's way more of a chance of there being a Tyler Mott tree than a Tanner Pearson tree.
Oh, there's more of an orchard. There's
yeah,
just
oh,
a
God.
Forest.
It's ooh.
It's called the American Hockey League.
Yeah, it's called the American Hockey League. Can you skate? Ah. You're like are you grateful for being in the show? Then you're tired.
You want to make a little bit less than you're worth?
Baby, we got a fourth line going. yeah, so that was really interesting in seeing that William Lockwood, yeah, just has speed for days.
Yeah.
Plays that kind of Michigan Wolverines type of style of hockey where it's very much abrupt, like in your face type of hockey, but at the same time. You know, you could see just on a few things, just like lack, like spatial awareness, like kind of reading play, the play, reading what's around him. But he's just like, he's just going. He has a speed and he goes. And hopefully, you know, they can rein that in. But, you know, then you look at your fourth line and that's what Patan, Chason, and I don't even know.
Richardson?
Yeah, Richardson. And then Richardson
had
was
a
like,
great scoring chance on Wednesday night.
I mean, yeah, he did. Great for the whiskey boy, whiskey drinker.
Didn't hit the net, but it looked good.
Didn't hit the net, but yeah. So now we're looking at like, you know, how much longer is this kind of go down for? You know, they're they're playing against the clock, and a loss tonight and a loss Wednesday. I mean, we'll see. It entirely depends on the teams around them, right? But if other teams are picking up points, like, you know, and even if they go ahead and they do make the playoffs, like, okay, so great, you're facing Colorado. You know,
I just want to see the team, you know, salvage whatever they have left of this run of these games and make a good college try to make in the playoffs. Like, yeah, if they make it in and they play Calgary or they play Colorado, yeah, they'll get destroyed if they play Colorado. But like, just the fact that they got there is fine enough for me. I'm not hell bent or financially invested in this team winning the Stanley Cup, but I am emotionally invested in this team trying their best to win every game. And you know you're not seeing it against St. Louis, but I want to see that, you know, in the stretch.
Yeah, I would love to do that too. But my problem is, and I think this goes back to the trauma that we've had the last 8 years, is like, if they make the playoffs, if they somehow miraculously pull this off, great for the team, great for the young people and kids, great for the Canucks fans who are not as diehard as other people. But like, I don't want this thing to turn into a thing where they make the playoffs and we get distracted about what this team really is. Like, I just don't want to do that. I just don't want to do that. I just don't. I'm this team is fundamentally flawed.
Yeah,
it is.
And they are correcting it, and they're doing it in the most basic way possible, which is paying your bottom, your fourth line, barely $1 million apiece.
Well, we'll see. I mean, we'll see. We'll see what happens going into the offseason.
This team hasn't even had a sniff at playoff possibilities, and the trauma of yesteryear, of betting year, has already got you worrying about a playoff
appearance. Well, because it's not even that. It's like this. There are specific members of this fan base who like cannot, like, they're more interested in being right and more interested about holding a position that they held in the last 8 years because it gave them a certain perspective and persona that they can't get over. But like, you just look at this team. This team cannot handle fast transition teams. They have no cap space. They have no prospects. Okay, they're in a position right now to slightly make a run to make a second wild card position. After 8 years of struggling, after 8 years of misery outside of one bubble run and one run with Radim Verbata and Ryan Miller and guest of the podcast, Sean Mathias. So after all of that, you look at the core pieces that they have that we're looking at. So it's JT Miller, who has 80 points this season. You have Elias Pettersson, the cast of characters you already know about.
Yeah, and we can't focus on what we're going to do with that cast of characters until these 14 games are done.
Yeah, I know that, but the problem, what I'm talking about is getting blinded by like being like, oh man, could you imagine if we had Bruce at the start, then we never would have been like doing that thing instead of looking at what this team really is, which is they are just plainly, just not good enough.
Yeah, they're not good enough. We've watched them play. We were talking about this on Thursday. We were talking about them playing, or on Friday. They're playing. It's almost more visible against heavy teams, like against Minnesota. Like, they were just, you know, they're not as fast against your Colorado teams, but then they also can't contend and compose themselves against a tougher skilled team like a Minnesota or a Dallas.
What are they?
They're like a team that's sitting on a bubble waiting to get a handful of key players moved in the offseason.
But yes, but my point being that are we moving these, like, this is the problem with keeping it until the draft and the offseason, is that now you've left again a fan base in limbo. And this is the problem.
Disagree.
And you know what? How, Ryan?
What are we in limbo about?
Okay. Oh my God. Okay. You've had a trade deadline where you had a miraculous trade where you've traded Travis Hamonic for a third, and then you flip Travis Hamonic for Travis Dermott. That's okay. Yeah. Fine. That's great. But now you've left this team, this fan base in limbo with the reporting ideas coming out of Elliot Friedman and everyone that, okay, well, they might keep JT and they might give him the Mika Zibanejad contract.
Yeah, the eight and a half that's floating around this week
so
is
Ryan,
terrifying.
They're waiting to move key assets. Okay, that's fine. But now you're leaving a fan base that has been filled with trauma of the last 8 years, leaving them in this pool of anxiety that all they can do now is, okay, so is it going to be business as usual?
Not at all, because I trust what this organization has said since they got here. They're in cap hell. They're not fast enough. They need to get younger and they need to get just more skilled. And there are desirable assets that we've spent an entire season of this podcast talking about. And then come the summer, somebody's getting moved. This is not the team going forward. And if they decide to go down the JT Miller extension route, which I really hope they don't, somebody, you know, other pieces are getting moved, or JT Miller's getting moved, because that's a price tag for, again, that's something I won't be able to tell you if it's good or bad until we're 5 years removed from it, because there's just no way to determine. There's no comparables, but some things are happening. People are getting moved. Something's going to happen in the offseason, and until then, I'm like, just make a run. Drive up the trade value of these, of whoever's here, and hope Brock Besser can shoot the puck a bit quicker so that when they move his rights at the deadline or at the draft, you know, they get a nice somewhat of return for him.
Yeah. I don't know. To me, all this stuff that's happening right now is, I don't know, maybe this is my problem, is like I can't find any joy in it.
You're going to the game on Wednesday night with your old man.
Yeah, and that's for my dad. That's not for me.
You're not going to have any fun there?
I'm going to have fun being with my dad, and less about going to see this team, you know, try and make a run. Like, I just don't, and maybe I'm being very nihilistic right now, but like, okay, Bruce, there it is, they make the run, and then, you know, you literally have the anything can happen crowd.
Yeah, but...
And then we have to hear about that shit if they make it, and they make it into the playoffs. We have to hear the, Bruce, there it is, everyone's being too negative, look what they did. And I'm like, are you guys watching the same effing games that I am? Are you guys able to, like, look at a squad of hockey players and not fundamentally see the patterns that are blasting them right in the face that they have to fix, that they have no ability to, and we're sitting here being like, oh, well, they'll move players. Well, we said they'd move players in December. We said, oh,
yeah, but,
well, they're trading Besser, you know, Frank Cervelli and everyone. Oh, they're trading Besser. But no, they're sitting on their hands because, they didn't get their price. They didn't get their price. Okay. So now we're going to go down to the offseason. Oh, what if they don't get their price then? What if the price is even lower in the offseason than it was at the deadline? And my problem is, I look at this team that needs to be fixed, that needs an infusion of youth, young legs, prospects, picks, something that should have been done the last, you know, 3-4 years to lead up to this wave. And the only thing we kind of have as fans to go by is, don't worry, we'll fix it.
I mean, why are we putting stock into what a cliched response to the playoffs that every fan base says? Anything can happen in the playoffs. Yeah, anything can happen
because
in the first round, which is a
No, Ryan.
Let them believe it. Who cares?
Ryan, people believe it the same way they believe in Christ.
Well,
this isn't like a minor window of fans.
Just because a couple of players, a couple of fans, you know,
it's not
a
couple of fans. It's literally
just because a section of the fan base is like, guys, hey, Rutherford, hey, Alvin, anything can happen in the playoffs. They're not going to be like, oh, man, we're a bunch of idiots. Our whole plan that we've been formulating since we got here, we got to throw it out the window because they finished second wild card and lost to Colorado in 5.
And that's what we said about Jim Benning, didn't we? That's what we said about Jim Benning.
We said a lot about Jim Benning.
Well, no, we said that's the same thing we said about Jim. Said, oh, he can't look at, like last year, he can't look at this and say, you know, this is good enough. He can't. And I'm and I don't want to I don't want to be too negative about the team right now because they're on this run and I wish them the best of luck. But I'm like in my head maybe I'm you know I'm because I'm rewatching The Sopranos and it's that episode where Anthony reads The Stranger and becomes nihilistic and he's like what's the point in life? But I'm like okay so the prize
it all
you
makes
get,
sense.
Yeah, the prize you get is you're out of the lottery. In Colorado in the first round.
And then what?
But what?
But I just don't,
I'm like, okay, yeah, all right, Colorado in the first round. Like, what is it? Like, this is the thing. The core group of youngsters on this team, they already have the playoff experience from the bubble. What kind of experience are they going to have getting their asses handed to them by,
you, don't
you
think
know,
they're
Gabriel
gonna...
Landeskog being like, I'm a man, you're a boy, boom.
Well, Nazem Kadri will get suspended early in game one, so then they'll be down. They won't be able to win every face-off, so that'll give the Canucks a fighting chance.
It's actually written in the Quran that Nazem Kadri is supposed to be
I do not disagree with your nihilistic mindset at this point due to Sopranos watching, because listen, I had my Sopranos viewing last year, and you know you start to look things a little grayer, but... I can't knock this team. I want to see them win as much as possible in this stretch. And I don't, I'm, do the Canucks have the luck? Am I going to base 50 years of good luck that the Canucks have had at the draft to think that this is the year they're going to get Shane Wright? I don't think so.
No, but it's now we're, see, like, I don't want to be too, it sucks because now, Ryan, we're in the middle. This is literally what the Calgary Flames middle is. This is the thing we were making fun of being a part. We were like, look at Calgary. Look at them. Look at Boston Pizza guys spending money and not getting anywhere.
Hey, wait a minute. Why are they trying Ferland and Dougie Hamilton for Lindholm and Hannifin? That doesn't seem to make... Oh no. God. You know what? I with bad games like the Detroit game or the Buffalo game or...
When the Canucks game. We couldn't score a goal against a team that has given up both 10 and 11 goals in a game this season, not this century, Ryan, this season.
I agree. And those are major eggs they're laying. But then you just see it. You'll see a stat on Twitter or someone will put it in perspective that like, oh, they're 7-2-1 in the last 10 games. And you go, well, shit. Those two have been pretty... noticeable, but you kind of got to remember this team's rattling off a lot of wins. They're playing their ass off.
But what,
and I don't want to see that. I know they'll burn out probably a little bit closer, a week or two from now, but I want to see them do as well as they can.
What I'm trying to get to is, like, I just don't know what this team is. What this team is in the idea that they play up to their opponents and play down to their opponents. I don't know what is the signifying thing with this core group of players. Elias Pettersson, okay, if Petey is your franchise rock, if he's the guy, he's your guy. Every team has a few guys. If your guys are like the only player in on this, the two players on this team that I look at that I'm like long view, I'm like, okay, these are value wise, you're probably not going to get better return in terms of their strict ability and impact on the game. It's Thatcher Demko and Quinn Hughes. And that is putting outside JT Miller and Elias Pettersson and Conor Garland and Bo Horvat and everyone.
Those are the two. Those guys show up every
and
night.
And so what I'm trying to get to is, so this core group of characters, like what is their movie called? Like what are they, a comedy? Are they a drama? Like what are they? I don't know. Is this a documentary? Is this a mockumentary? Is this,
a coming of age tale?
Is this a Lars von Trier horror movie about the existentialism of, you know, whatever? I bring out existentialism.
You know what it is? It's Making a Murderer on Netflix.
A documentary.
It was pretty good, but if it was about three episodes shorter, it would have been really good. But they got all that filler in the middle. They're making you dragging things out.
I just really hope that, I guess the thing that I'm frustrated with is like, I just really hope that, regardless of what happens, this team comes out next year with, like, a clear idea of what they are. Like, if you want to be a big, bruising Brian Burke team, then just... I'm not agreeing that that's what you should do, but just pick do something. Pick something. Pick a sign above the goddamn door that says speed, hitting, doing deeks. You know, 1-3-1, like whatever it is. Because when I watch this team, there's so many moments where I watch this team and it's like they're just waiting for, like, JT, save us.
Yeah.
Petey, save us. Instead of like a unit, instead of an actual squad. And that this is the problem, is that individually there's some amazing moments that this team has. But as a well-oiled machine, like it seems like there's just a lot of really big spare parts on this team that don't amount to an actual...
A lot of passengers?
Like, no, well, not passengers, but just like a lot of... Like, I have a USB cord... a milk churner, a toenail clipper, bottle of sriracha, and I don't know, a Game Boy Advance.
How many of those are really in front of you right now?
Like 4. And so, and to me, I'm like, okay, unless I'm MacGruber and I can somehow take all these things and make it into a bomb. I just don't know what this is. And I look at the prospects and stuff coming up. I'm like, okay, so there's no players that are coming up that are going to define what this team is.
Yeah.
And so I hope that the move, like, I know I'm skipping ahead, but I'm really not. Everyone's like, oh, playoffs, yeah, Bruce Stardust. I'm like, okay, great. I think I've been a Canucks fan. I've gotten to the point, precipice of my life, where I've been a Canucks fan for too long. Where I just, you know, you're just this sunken ball of pessimism and misery.
Yeah, it's like our fathers. They've seen 3 Stanley Cup losses.
Yeah, I mean, oof. We
generations of Cup losses.
Generations of Cup losses. So I just hope that the moves that they make are like, don't just move like the chaise lounge, you know? Like, let's add a new gut. Let's change it up. Let's
knock a wall down. Let's open this mother up.
Let's dig some holes, and not just for the heck of it. You know,
I got to agree with you, but I can't dwell on what hasn't happened yet. I can't. I think that was
we
that Wayne
Gita,
Gretzky. I can't worry about a shot I haven't taken yet.
Let's talk about shots we've taken, huh?
Hey everybody, just want to thank you all for listening, taking the time to download, to subscribe, to follow to us. It means a lot. I want to make sure that you are following us on Twitter at PucksNetCA or PucksNetCa. It's going to mean a lot to us. It'll mean a lot to Arash now that he's got the login after about a year of trying. If you want to buy the rights to the Caw, which we say at the top of the show, you can. You can do that by pledging a couple of bucks over at patreon.com/pucksonnet. You pledge $5 American to get instant access to all our bonus content, and you pledge $10 a month for a month of sponsorship. So if you got a message you want to get across, you want to plug some project you're doing or a good cause, $10 monthly Patreon donation will do that. For $5, though, per month, you get access to all of our weekly bonus content. This includes video podcasts. If you want to watch the whole show in video, I know a handful of people do on our Pucks on Net Patreon. You can get access to our bonus segment, 5 minutes for paying, which we record immediately after the regular free show is done. We also have monthly bonus episodes. You can see our show notes. You can see what keeps me and Arash and Gita in between the lines on any given week. And, of course, you get instant access to our exclusive Pucks on Net Discord server, which, hey, that's the life of the party right there. If you don't want to support the show monetarily, you don't want to support the show on Patreon, that's totally fine. Here's a way you can help us out. You can follow us on your favorite podcast platform. Rate and review us on Apple Podcasts or Spotify. Help thwart that awful algorithm. Help us get promoted on these apps and deal with the big dog shows. Other ways you can support us. Head to YouTube. We put out a few video clips every week on our YouTube channel. please go hit the subscribe button, smash that bell, or whatever crap YouTubers say. But basically, go to youtube.com/pucksonnet. Give us a follow. Check out our clips. You can listen to the podcast there. You can watch segment clips there. It ain't bad. We put a little time in there. So we'd love it if you could give us a subscribe. Other ways to support the show: tell a friend, post about the podcast. If you listen to us on Spotify, share this week's podcast on your Instagram stories. Just help us get the word out about Pucks on Net. And we've got the Pucks on Net mailbag. Send us something. PucksOnNetCA@gmail.com. Or hey, if you actually want to physically send us something, hit me up in an email. I'll give you the address here of the old haunted Burger King. But enough of me yakking. Let's get back to this damn show.
Yeah, Ryan and I are about to go to war with each other.
One second here. Why are we going to war?
Because you did something.
What did I do?
Okay. We need the listener's help.
Okay.
So Ryan and I went, and I'm not going to lie, we tied one on. We were supposed to go for a little drinky poo, but I think we also felt like, oh my God, we feel a little normal in this bar that we like to go to that's small enough and, you know, it's quiet enough. And we're like, you know, we're by ourselves and we're enjoying our time.
We've gone for nightcaps in the past in the neighborhood, the lovely Hastings Sunrise. And that came, if you had messaged me 30 minutes later, I would have been asleep. But I'm like, no, let's do this. I also feel like going out for a sneaky ale or two was needed. I felt that we needed that out of each of us. So we go to Bad Apple and I'm just going to order a beer or something. And Arash is like, oh, there's triple Long Islands on special for $12.
That was the biggest mistake.
Well, I think it's what you paired them with.
Shot of Fireball.
So our first drink for our nightcap was a triple Long Island and a shot of Fireball. And then we proceeded to book the Canucks off-season, the podcast plans for world domination. And
Ryan's going to win the Lotto Max and buy the Canucks rights. That was his plan.
Yeah, that's the plan, and it's foolproof if you ask me. And then I do love where... You know, I realized that if I keep drinking triple Long Island iced teas, this is not going to be a good night. No. So I ask for a bottle of Corona, and they go, well, we only have cans. And to this, it was like I just saw the president get assassinated in Dallas, Texas. Where I'm like, what?
Ooh.
Cans? I'm like, can you still give me a lime?
He's like, yeah.
He's like, I'm like, oh, okay. So then I just proceeded to jam these limes into these cans of Corona, because for all you kids out there, a Corona with a lime is an S-tier beer, one of the best. A Corona without a lime is just garbage pee water.
Yeah, it's just pee water.
And then we proceeded to keep drinking, and then somebody, I can't remember who, it might have been an Iranian fella, was like, oh, we got to go to Church's Chicken. It's 2:00 in the morning. We got to go to Church's Chicken. I need to get fries and gravy. And I was just ready to go home. But we go to Church's Chicken, and then he's taking photographs to spin it as if I am the mastermind behind getting chicken. And then I proceed, like in Grand Theft Auto, to sit with my chicken on top of a garbage can and just, right, you know, just shoveling it down at 2:00 in the morning, which is something I haven't done in a very long time.
Okay. So can I explain what happened? So here's Ryan Schapp, right? He orders his chicken.
So I ordered chicken and fries
stop.
And gravy.
You had your point. You had your part, okay?
For the listeners.
You've been talking a lot. You've been talking. Your Honor, may I approach the bench?
Your Honor, the Canucks have not made or been eliminated from the playoffs yet. Can we focus on what has happened in the last week?
Your Honor, Bruce, there it is.
I rest my case.
Bruce, there it is. Anyway, so Ryan orders this goddamn chicken, right? And he goes and he places this chicken on top of a garbage receptacle with a lid on it. And he proceeds to eat this chicken on top of this garbage receptacle, which might be like one of the most filthy, rancid garbage receptacles in all of Hastings.
I had a buffer.
No, hey. You're going to sit there and I'm going to do my testimony. Okay. You're going to sit there and you're going to listen. None of this. Okay. You want, okay. You want contempt of court, Ryan? Do you want contempt of court? No, you don't. So sit there. So anyway, he's eating this goddamn chicken, right? And then after I think he's done probably like 3/4 of it, Ryan, in how I can only describe would be the like the physical manifestation of white privilege, takes like this, noting that the garbage is right there in front of him. Like we're talking like inches away. Ryan turns to his left and as if throwing a softball to his child one day, hucks this chicken carcass, this once living being, and instead of respecting it for giving it the giving him the nourishment that he required after his drinking, underhand throws this carcass into the street. And I look at Ryan with only laughter and bewilderment on my face saying, Ryan, did you just throw that chicken into the street? And he was like, yeah, it was just bones. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I don't know about you, but I feel like we only got one Earth. We only got one planet. Now, would it be crazy of me to say, hey, let's take care of our planet. Not only that, let's take care of our streets. Huh? What if a dog, right? Yana, answer me this. Okay, I got one thing. What if a dog, a really cute dog, is walking down the street, right? Cute as about, let's say a shih tzu, right? Walking down, all right? And then this dog goes to this pile of bones thrown by the whitest man you've ever seen. Because he's like, oh, some Iranian's going to come clean this up in the morning. I don't even have to worry about it. Some shih tzu comes, eats that, gets the bone stuck in its gullet, has a tummy ache. God forsake me if anything happens to the dog. Who's going to pay for it? Is it Ryan? No. You know who's going to pay for it? The Iranian man who did not clean up the bones in the morning. Ryan, you got anything you want to say for yourself?
I would just like to say that Arash is altering this story to benefit himself as the protagonist.
Oh, hang my on. Own, I object.
I gave you your time. We were walking away from my garbage receptacle that was a dinner table, which is, and you might... The people at home, they know this. When you are drunk eating food, and let's say it's chicken, you want to start removing as much as possible. So when it comes time to just reach in, you're not grabbing chicken bones. You're not grabbing garbage. So I flung it into the middle of Hastings Street, which for those that aren't from Vancouver, I threw a couple of chicken bones in one of the busiest furrow fairs in the Metro Vancouver Regional District. No, that's GVRD, Greater Vancouver. So there's no dogs walking. There's no dogs walking around eating these bones.
There's no dogs walking around at Hastings Sunrise, Ryan.
Not in the middle of Hastings Street.
That makes it okay. You're justifying it.
For those that are curious, there was a video captured that I have not put onto Patreon yet.
No, Ryan.
That Arash.
Answer me this.
Yeah. That of Arash.
Or did you not throw a chicken carcass in the street when a garbage was available specifically for the purposes of discarded chicken carcasses that is owned by the company that you purchased said chicken from?
We were on the move at the time. I had to think
twice.
No,
we were not.
Yes, we were.
We were waiting for my order while you...
Maybe we were.
Oh. Your Honor, I rest my case.
The point is, Arash,
Ryan, we live in Ryan Schapp's world, and we're privileged to live in there, and we should all bow down and abide by his ruling because he is Daria, he is Meredith Grey, he is Tony Soprano, he is, give me another main character of a show that isn't like ensemble based show.
The Drew Carey.
The Drew Carey. He is Drew Carey.
I don't know why I said Drew. I think the main reason Arash is so upset is because he told me on Sunday that he was hungover for a day and a half.
I woke up Saturday morning.
I woke up Saturday morning fresh as the daisy.
Yeah, because you're a drunk. Are you?
No.
All right. Well, that's not what
I just know. I just know how to.
That's not what
I just know how to. I just know how Bruce There It Is works when you go into a place.
I'm just saying that's not what my dad told me. And you and my dad are really close.
Arash, we gotta get back to hockey here.
Okay,
we have a very fun question.
Okay, I do have some serious and kind of sad news that just broke.
What?
Unfortunately, Eugene Melnyk passed away.
Really?
He just passed away.
That's awful. He had his... it's 62?
Yeah, it is with great sadness that the family of Eugene Melnyk and the Ottawa Senators hockey organization announced his passing on March 28th, 2022, after an illness he faced with determination and courage.
That's awful.
That is very awful.
Now, he had issues with, didn't he need a kidney transplant?
I have no clue. I'm not going to comment on that stuff because I don't
know. Oh, yeah, here it is. A liver transplant in 2015 after a public appeal for the live liver donor, and they had the appeal to Sens fans. That was 7 years ago, but that's very sad news, and that's, you don't want to see anybody go that young. And
yeah, I know. You listen, we're not going to sugarcoat it. You know, I think a lot of people understand that with Eugene Melnyk on how he ran a hockey organization, might have not been the most popular person at times in terms of that fan base, but again, just you never want to see someone go too early.
Yeah, and that is far too early.
That is far too early, and to, you know, Senators fans and everyone out there, you know, you're seeing a team that's on the precipice of being built from the ground up, right back again, on the precipice of competing, and you've kind of look at the parallels between the Ottawa Senators and the Vancouver Canucks. It's like, hey man, Senators, they've suffered for a while, and they got some
bullets
in the chamber.
Look what they got coming up. Yeah. So, yes, they do.
But sad news about Eugene Melnyk passing. And
well, nothing but thoughts for the Melnyk family, man.
Do we want to go into questions, Ryan?
Well, I have there's still a fair bit to talk about.
Yes, sir.
But I do want to ask a question.
Yep.
And it's from a former Ottawa senator, and it was Evgenii Dadonov, the probably one of the stranger NHL controversies of the modern era, where he was traded in a cap hustle for RK-17, and the logistical nature behind his paperwork submitted was not tickety-boo, was not kosher, and the deal was voided.
Mm-hmm.
And the Golden Knights and their inability to take Mark Stone and others off of LTIR is Alec Martinez too, is the only thing that the Canucks are clinging to as hope to get into the playoffs. But they're screwed. Any way you cut it, they don't have any goaltenders. Dadonov came back on his revenge tour, which you love to see when a player is kind of cast aside, which is the original nature of the Vegas Golden Knights, of we're all misfits. Well, he was a misfit on the misfit team. Comes back, has 5 points since the trade was vetoed, 2 goals, 3 assists. Incredible kind of resiliency. But Richard in our Pucksnet Discord, which you can get access to if you're a $5 Patreon backer, he goes, in honor of the Dadonov debacle, What 10 teams would the PON hosts have on their no trade list?
Ooh, that's good. Ooh, that's good. Wait, Ryan, did you already make your list?
I know a few that are on it.
Okay.
I wouldn't want to go to Minnesota.
Oh, boo. Why not?
Weather.
Weather? Boring. Vancouver weather, just a little bit of more snow.
I mean, listen.
You just watched Fargo and you don't want to move to Minnesota? Get out of here. Sadly, they don't have any streets for you to just throw chicken bones in, you chicken chucker.
My next one is Calgary, based on personal beliefs.
Accurate.
The Calgary Saddle Dome is stinky because it got flooded. And although I do feel like I would flourish under Daryl Sutter, I don't want to wear that jersey.
Nice.
We'll go to the New York Rangers.
What?
I don't want to play there.
You don't want to play in New York?
No, I don't want to play for an organization that just idolizes moose. Crazy. I'll play in Long Island. It's easier to get
insane.
To.
You don't want to play in Madison Square Garden.
No, maybe as a road team, but crazy. Like, look at the people insane. That look. I don't. Do I like Brian Leetch? No. Insane. Do I like Mike Richter? No. Insane. Do I like Mark Messier? No.
What has Mark Messier ever done that we should have negative feelings towards? Where's the napkin?
I'm gonna put Vegas on my no trade list as well.
Yeah, Vegas would be exhausting.
Mm-hmm. And who else? No, I do like Buffalo. I got no qualms with Buffalo. Chicago for ethical reasons, but maybe they can change their ways. That's five. Edmonton, just because. Montreal, because. And Carolina Hurricanes.
Nice.
What about you?
Okay. So let's see. All right. I'm gonna figure this out.
Hang on. That was only eight. Throw New Jersey and St. Louis on there.
Okay. So my list is gonna be. Like goes like this, okay? It's going to be Dallas, St. Louis, Nashville, Carolina, Tampa, Florida, Columbus, Chicago. Wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then let's do Chicago. And then who else? Vegas, yeah.
Yeah.
So how many is that?
I lost count because I started laughing at that they were all south of the Mason-Dixon line.
Yeah, so there's Vegas. And then, if I had to have one more.
Any Canadian teams?
Edmonton. Oh, Edmonton for sure. But yeah, I'm very glad that you kept, you understood what my rationale was for teams I wouldn't go to. I don't want to go to any teams where I'm going to be referred to as boy. So,
skate harder, my Marcia Day. Come on, boy. Get hot. Come on now. Get on. Come on. We want that cup, boy. Why are you not using your gosh darn legs? I thought that's what you kids do over there.
You know, that thing. I don't want to. Not going to do that.
I love it.
Great question. What a fantastic question.
Yeah, there are some doozies. I think there's another one from Richard in the Discord, but you know, during the plugs, the Pucksnet Discord is a fun place ever since I tricked Arash into turning on his notification for ats.
Can I oh, amazing quote by Bruce about Conor Garland tonight.
Okay, what is it?
So this is Bruce Boudreau on Conor Garland after the 4-1 loss against the St. Louis Blues tonight. Bruce Boudreau, he didn't play very well, and I need more out of him. You've got to use your teammates, and I think he could have passed the puck. He carried it a little too much, and he was one of the forwards I didn't think had a very good game. Yeah. Like, he's on his own island.
Yeah.
He's just, you know, it's like he's dangling, like, trying to beat himself.
And if I out-deke myself, I can out-deke all these St. Louis Blues.
Yeah, and it's like, okay, well, like, you gotta make a play. You can't just, you know, like, toe drag behind the net, and then when you don't see anything, try this, like, Hail Mary 360 backhand pass.
And you're not really given Pearson and Miller any reason to move their feet and get in position, because you just keep out-deking yourself against the boards in the corner, not looking to set them up anyway. It's kind of, yeah, it's a bit, he had a very uninspired game this tonight.
Yeah.
Let's go to some housekeeping.
I just read of something both extremely offensive and hilarious, but by a friend of the show, Mike Noble.
Oh, okay.
I will not read on air. But
that's fine. Okay. That's for the spicy part between the show and 5 minutes we're paying.
All right.
Where we're not recording. A couple of tidbits, a couple of bit of house cleaning. Keep you up to date in the world of sports. Battle of Alberta. We were cheering for the Calgary Flames on Saturday night, and they delivered, beating the ever-loving shit out of the Edmonton Oilers, who unfortunately are beating the Arizona Coyotes 4-1 in the second period right now. So playoff hopes diminishing.
Not great, but, Ryan. Not great.
Not the best.
Bruce, there it is.
Listen,
just need to Bruce, there it is, a little harder.
Jesus Christ. You found out Santa Claus ain't real, and look what happened to you, pal. 4-2 now, Arizona. But, yeah, Johnny Gaudreau had 5 assists in 7 minutes of 5-on-5 minutes. The Flames scored 6 of their 9 goals against the Oilers off the rush. Somebody online made a joke saying Calgary really exploited how confused Edmonton gets when they have to back check and switch to the left-right sides.
Yeah, which... just understand that this is... I'm really glad we're talking about this, because it is really... this is stuff I'm really passionate about talking about, because it's so fun, because it's not us. Because as much of a shit show as the Vancouver Canucks can be, and have less of being a shit show lately, but have been for the last 7 years, like, this mantle is clearly owned by one team.
Oh my God.
There's no other, like, maybe Chicago, maybe the Blackhawks, just in terms of like off ice putrid conduct, but in terms of strictly hockey operations.
Oh, Edmonton. How can we screw up this week? They'll find a way.
How can you, like, Ken Holland just fucking Vince McMahon walking to the trade deadline, be like, oh, I like our goaltending when it's healthy. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, who's that? Kakanen got moved for a fifth? We don't need him. Okay, so... I'm just baffled that, like, you've surrounded Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl with this. This is like a bizarro world version of what would have happened if Pittsburgh, like, went wrong.
Yeah.
If Pittsburgh just, like, completely just didn't have, like, they didn't have Fleury, they didn't insulate properly, Ray Shero, like, didn't figure it out.
Well, you know who figured it out?
Ken
Jimmy
Holland.
Rutherford.
Yeah, he did. But then, yeah. You know, Ken Holland, he won. Listen, he
well,
won
don't
a couple
worry,
cups.
They got the right...
He won a couple cups with Nicholas Lidstrom and a bunch
you
of
You know
Hall
my
of
favorite game, Arash, my favorite game, because you bring up Ken Holland, Stanley Cups, is go look at your well-respected, successful general managers and find out how quickly, before the cup run, they were... brought in as GM, because Shirelli, Ken Holland, it was Steve Yzerman's team before Brisebois came in.
Can I say something? Like, in terms of coaches and general managers, how many of, like, these actual coaches and general managers in the NHL have won Stanley Cups with, like, clearly talent-deficient teams? You know what I'm talking about? Like, teams that... were clear, like, the like one would be in a sense the closest, like, one of the closest I can think of is like 2004 Anaheim on the backs of, like, Jaguar, I guess.
Yeah.
Or
the Hurricanes,
you know, 2000, the 1999, or like the 2000 Florida Panthers. Like, this is what I mean, is I so rarely do we find these people, like the Ken Hollands,
mm-hmm.
have this track record of being like, oh, they're winners. But I'm like, yeah, but who did you have with you? Like, you had 9 Hall of Famers on your goddamn team.
All taking pay cuts. So
all
they could
taking
win
pay
one more
cuts
cup.
To play together. Mm-hmm. And, like, now you're a genius? Like, what? Like, wait, what? Like, I'm pretty sure, like, my Iranian dog could have been, you know, just, like, sitting there chewing on a bone. And they're like, Seth, what are we going to do? And he's like, she's like, okay, we'll sign Paul Coffey. All right, no problem. Like, you know?
You think we can do it?
We think we can do it, girl? I'll take that as a yes. Let's go, boys.
Dominic Hasek just had a year off to rest his ailing groin. He's willing to sign on the cheap. The dog's a genius.
Chris Osgood, who? Get him out of here. Mike Vernon, get out.
You referenced the stat earlier in the show, but the Pittsburgh Penguins beat the shit out of the Red Wings 11-2 on the weekend.
Can score a goal on them. All the Canucks needed to do was like score one.
Brad Hunt, one goal.
Brad Hunt. Where was Brad Hunt?
So this is incredible, and there's still 14 or so games to go for Detroit, but the Wings have now had games this season where they've given up 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 goals against. So we're cheering for a foot long for Detroit Rock City. We want them to give up 12.
I mean, that'll be a bingo card. I still believe in the Shanna plan. Or not the Shanna plan, sorry, the Steve Yzerman plan. See, now I'm thinking of Detroit Red Wings. I'm thinking about Ken Holland stuff.
Thinking about Shanny, thinking about Steve Yzerman, thinking about one of them doing it right.
Larionov, Fetisov, Konstantinov, Milkshakeov,
Darren
Big Mac
McCarty.
Darren McCarty, Chris Draper. Ooh, well, I mean, okay, now this makes sense. I am reading Blood Feud. The Adrian Dater, Colorado Avalanche. Red Wings, folks. So now it makes sense why my brain is like this. Shout out to Adrian Dater.
Good book so far?
Huh?
Is it a good book so far?
Yeah, it's good. It's okay.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm enjoying it. I'll finish it probably soon.
Couple Eastern Conference housekeeping, we'll wrap it up. The Leafs are in the second wild card spot. They're behind Washington right now, which is... it ain't what you expected, but it also kind of is. And finally, the Sens signed Jake Sanderson. That's Jeff Sanderson's son, to the three-way entry-level deal now that he's done at North Dakota. And depending on who you ask or what day of the week it is, or what Pierre Maguire has to say, that is that's Travis Hamonic's mentee. Or it's the other guy. They don't really know.
Ooh.
And Claude Giroux, Arash.
Yeah, what about him?
Stealing Jonathan Huberdeau's assist thunder on the top line. He's got 4 in 3 games.
Yeah, because it's crazy what happens when you play on a team that is actually tailored around the way you want to play hockey.
When did Sasha Barkov become like one of the greatest players in the league?
He's always been this good. He's been crazy. But it's just he plays in Florida, and until mainstream media wants to actually pay attention.
Because you always heard positive things about him and Huberdeau's top 10 in scoring, but when they're like, Claude Giroux is going to play with Sasha Barkov, everybody's eyes just bulge out of their heads like this is the two-headed monster the East needs.
Good quote by JT Miller. They had a better start than we did. We play them again in 2 nights, and we're going to put forth a better effort then. You better.
You got
my dad.
Better?
My goddamn dad's going to be in attendance.
I'm. You think I can always.
Sean Mamarzadeh is going to put up with your shit. He's going to rush the bench.
He's going to throw that.
Why are you like this? I don't understand.
The game starts at seven, guys.
With $500, 2 business degrees, I drive cab. Now we own house in most beautiful place, and we own restaurant. You come here crying like, oh no, I have giveaway. Oh no. Bruce, there it is. We don't like Bruce, there it is. Oh no. Why you like this? Conor Garland, why you do this? Like, why? There's old Iranian saying, okay? Old Iranian saying. I don't know.
Just make something up.
There's old Iranian saying, okay? 2 candy bar does not make you Willy Wonka. Okay? I don't know why. Okay.
Dude, you could have said that in Farsi and everyone would be like, oh yeah, you could have bought yourself some time.
Yeah, it's the Sigur Rós thing. Have I ever told you the story? It's really funny. So
I think
the the lead singer of Sigur Rós, at one point, I think it was just at a festival, forgot the lyrics to one of their songs and began making up words in Icelandic and then realized that no one in the crowd spoke Icelandic. So no one really knew that what they were singing was gibberish.
Bjork wasn't there. He was fine.
Yeah, he was fine. And so, you know, I could be like, you know, I could be like doing my Arabic impersonation, which is like, and then white people would be like, oh, yeah, no, he makes some good points. I'm like, no.
Arash had a lot of positive things to say.
He had a lot of positive things to say. I don't know.
All right, let's get some questions here. CSWC Andy, we didn't mention this once, which is just goes to show how quickly this crashed and burned and was over with. Any theories as to why Will Smith slapped Chris Rock? Made fun of his wife on a very emotional day.
I don't know how much I want to talk about this.
Ugh, the discord.
It's just like both sides. Everyone's wrong, and it's not in the position of. Okay, to be very frank, it's not in the position of white people to speculate, and it's especially not in the position of white men and women to then use this certain situation to talk about their own trauma. This is like something very completely different. It's not a thing for you to use on as your platform to, you know, make it about you. Like, you need to, it's not about you, you're not invited to the table, and that's okay, but just you're not invited to the table. This is like Kay and the Godfather and closing the door. It's like, you're not invited in. Don't take offense, but you're just not invited.
You saw it, but it doesn't concern you.
Yeah. It's awful because it's like, okay, a joke was made in ill taste. That joke is then responded to with violence. But there is also cultural effects that there's stuff that you and I and people that are listening won't understand. Because it might be completely rooted in a cultural thing where in your perspective of your societal view on things, you might think, oh, this is not right, blah, blah. But we don't know. It's not within our point. It's also a bummer that I totally believe this, that this also sets a precedent for people who go to comedy shows that don't agree with the comedy to think that it's okay to do that. It's like, no. Like, listen, I give full avenue and right for comedians to do what they do. They have to be good at it. They can't just go and just say the N-word being like, this is funny. No. You have full carte blanche to wade into waters that normally people are afraid to wade into. That is what comedy is. But, you know, sometimes, like, yeah, you have to be also responsible sometimes to the reactions of others and how that you make them feel. But violence is never the answer. It just all sucks.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's all a pretty big bummer. Everyone in that situation is wrong. That was not right. It would have been great. Sorry, we're going to end it here, but it would have been great if Chris Rock had said what he said, and then Will just said what he said.
Yeah.
Instead of the going up and resorting to violence.
And then the Academy
Award. That would have nipped it in the bud.
Yeah.
That really would have nipped it in the bud.
Instead, every party involved was very in the wrong.
Yeah, everyone just made an ass of themselves. So.
Speaking of people that don't make an ass of themselves, Andy Lau on Twitter, what's the Canucks equivalent to Kelly O'Brien's pachos? Do you know what Kelly O'Brien's pachos are, Arash?
I have no idea.
Well, Kelly O'Brien's and Carlos O'Brien's are staples in small Canadian, Western Canadian towns, and they are very revered. A pacho is a lattice-style fries seasoned with our signature spice topped with cheddar cheese and green onions served with a bowl of Emerald Isle.
There's one in Vancouver, isn't there?
Yeah, one in Kits.
In Kits, yeah, I've been to that. Okay, yeah. It's like a it's like a shenanigans type bar.
Yeah.
Oh, so what was the question? Sorry.
What is the Canucks equivalent to Kelly O'Brien's pachos? And I would just like to say, because I don't know anybody that says anything positive about Kelly O'Brien's except that these pachos are really good. So naturally, Thatcher Demko is the Kelly O'Brien's pachos of the Vancouver Canucks.
I'll take your word for it.
Steve asks, if you could choose for one meal only, Duffin's Donuts or me and Ed's Pizza?
One meal?
Yeah.
Duffin's, just because there's so much more stuff.
Yeah, and I also...
And I work at a pizza place, and I'm kind of sick. Pizza's overrated. I'm so sick of pizza.
I will say that me and Ed's, I believe I had it once. It was mostly crust, so that's not my type of pie. Matt DeBoer on Twitter, was there any inspiration from the Canadian men's soccer team that you took today? They won, so that's pretty cool.
The inspiration that I got was that none of us will be attending in Dubai, in Qatar. The inspiration I also took off is this World Cup was never built for anyone but the super, supremely rich. And as great as our Canadian boys going and fighting and playing for the World Cup, also understand that this World Cup came at a price of a lot of lives and a lot of people's just read up on it, indoctrinate yourself
in FIFA and this World
and
Cup
the bullshit that comes with it, especially with what's going on in Qatar. So
yeah, finally,
go Canada though. Go get them.
Arash wants two things. He wants the Canucks in the playoffs, and he wants the Canucks in the World Cup.
Sure, you chicken thrower. I just want you to stop throwing chicken.
Richard on the Discord, any reaction to Petey getting his 199th and 200th career point last game? 230 games played, 200 points, 85 goals. For me, it kind of snuck up on me a bit and makes you think that he's been in this league since 16, 17. Or is it 17? No, it's 18, 19.
Yeah.
So he's on 3 years, and that's for 200 points over that time. That's pretty damn good.
Yeah, he just has to show it more. More consistency. Yeah. They need him to be what he was in that Dallas game. But he can't do that every 15 games.
No, he needs to do it
that's what he just needs to be. Are you the guy? And if you are the guy, then you need to produce like the guy. And if you can't produce like the guy, then guess what? You're not the guy.
Yeah, you don't see Austin Matthews scoring 47 goals every five games.
We don't even have to use Austin Matthews. Like, let's take one tier below that. Matt Barzal.
Oh, he's the guy.
He's a guy. He's a guy. You can say he's a guy. Yeah. Like Petey, it's like, are you the man? He's the man. Becky Lynch, WrestleMania this weekend. Hey, yo, brother. Oh, look at Ryan just typing away.
That's where we'll wrap up the podcast this week.
Oh, come on, you chicken throat. Wrap it up. I love you.
What's wrong with me throwing chicken in the street? God, oh my you God. Have your priorities.
Why are you throwing food in the street?
It's
like
compost.
An animal. Are you an animal? Are you a dog?
You're an animal.
Well, thank everybody for listening.
You're a junkyard dog. Oh, that's what we'll call you. The junkyard dog. And you'll come out to the ring with a bunch of half-eaten chunks of bone. And you'll say,
Junkyard Dog
it's
was a
time.
Very popular wrestler with that name before he came to the World Wrestling Federation.
They'll love it. It's you.
Go listen. Hey, everybody, we'll let you go here. Go listen to our new Patreon bonus episode where Arash food shames me for about 45
it's a
minutes.
Bone. You'll be a bone. You will call you Bone Man.
Let me see them bones. Good night, everybody.
It has nothing to do with voodoo.